I'm Craig Dumont, and I'm with Dr. Terry Cross today for a new edition of a program for Dominion Leadership Network. This time we're going to be talking about the historical atom. It would seem that that's a very hot topic. We've been covering quite a few hot topics lately.
Yeah.
I was joking before we went on. I was thinking of a fun way to enter this, and I think maybe we might be a little over the top, but it does seem like some of the great doctrines that have been hashed out over the years, Terry, have been brought up in maybe a new context, but with the same effect of wiping out some doctrines that the church holds as already hard fought and won and implemented and orthodox, I guess, if you will. Mm-hmm. Not that there can't be a develop of doctrine and expansion or new understandings, but it seems like that the new attacks or the new debates are going far beyond that. Mm-hmm. And at least it does to me. You're kind of like the pelican. You're real affair, and I'm kind of like Luther. I'm like a bomb thrower. But it does seem like there's something extra at work here that's mm-hmm. not just debating doctrines on how maybe implementation or things. It's actually an attack on certain doctrines, it seems to me.
Okay.
And we've talked about atonement, and this one is actually something that is raging across Christian academic circles, and that is whether there was actually a historical Adam or not, and it's getting a little bit like trench warfare out there.
Yeah, and some people's jobs at certain schools are kind of dependent on how they will answer that question. So it reminds me of the similar question about inerrancy back in the 70s with the battle for the Bible. And it's not unrelated in some sense, because I think where this one comes from is a look at what is the scripture and how can we tell what really happened and what didn't.
Mm-hmm.
So since about the 1830s, with F.C. Bauer, a German scholar, we have had a pretty strong cycle of people who want to look at the scripture from a more literary and historical perspective without the lens of faith.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have a problem if they want to do that, but my question would be why?
Mm-hmm.
It just doesn't seem to be the reason why scripture was written. John says these things were written so that you might believe, and believing you might have life.
Mm-hmm.
So there's something here that is meant to cause a reaction in us in response.
Mm-hmm.
If you eliminate that potential, then you're just dicing words and you'll have endless debates.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is especially true in the story of Adam.
Yeah, a lot of this comes from the rise of evolutionary thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Recently, I know that you can go back, probably all the way to Origen and some of the others and find their discussion about whether Adam is historical or not. But the new aspect comes from a belief in scientism more than a belief in the Bible. It seems to me. I want to be real careful here, because these are, you and I hold some differences of opinions on some of these, and you could be wrong on something. No, I'm kidding. So I want to be careful, because some of these are my opinions. I definitely, I've said this in other venues, not with you, but I'm a young Earth guy, but I understand some of the old Earth. I can do it, but that's where I come from. But I'm stunned at the acceptance of evolutionary theory, especially because evolutionary theory isn't new. It goes back to the Egyptians, and in fact, you could actually argue that they might have a more sophisticated and believable approach to evolution than what we have today. And from my perspective, and I've done a lot of work on this, evolution is not science, it's more a philosophy. It was almost overnight that people looked at a skull And it used to be a deformed person that was, you know, and then overnight, it, you know, it was some evolutionary, you know, link. And they, you know, they build these models on, you know, eight bones. Mm-hmm. And overnight, you know, and someone says it's a couple million years old. So then they design their readings to accommodate that. And so it's just from my perspective. And again, I want to make sure that I'm speaking for me and not for you. I just think it's a capitulation to a scientific. It's not anti-science where we stand, but they have moved into a scientism that a belief that, you know, it's a belief. We believe in it. We believe in it. We're accepting it. And if you don't believe in it, then you're a heretic. And so they've switched a belief system from a belief in God's word to a, from my perspective, to a belief in scientism, which stands opposed to that. That's my perspective.
Yeah, well, I can very much appreciate that. My problem with talking about origins is it's not always clear. Well, let me give you an example. So in 1:1 it says, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth." But then the next verse, "Now the earth was formless and empty, darkness was over the face of the deep." How do we get from God creating it to it being formless? Well, some people have decided that they would go between the cracks of the verses and fill in all that information. So where were dinosaurs? The gap theorists say, "Oh, it was right in there." That's a lot of reading into something that isn't said. There's, if you think about it, there's a whole lot more not said here than is said.
Yes.
So where Scripture is clear, I think we have to be clear. And where it has left some room and it hasn't described it like a scientific textbook, then I think we need to leave some room of, I don't know. So what do we know from chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Genesis? I think what we're supposed to take away from this is that God made everything that is. Everything. That is not only, that's a statement of faith. It can be argued outside of faith, but it's a statement of belief. Martin Luther, your friend here, said when he would recite the creed in his catechism, he would say to the children, "So who is God the Creator? It's God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." It isn't just someone who made the world, but this is a God who also made me. So if you have, if you try to figure this out like a scientific textbook, like there's light on the first day, and then but there's not the sun until later, and you know, there's some specific things that look strange. When if we were trying to describe it scientifically, Genesis 1 isn't about in the beginning there was hydrogen and oxygen and they were put together to make water. It just doesn't think or operate that way. And in the same way, it's telling the story not so much to provide us a video camera of the events, but highlighting the story in such a way that these are the things that are important for you to know. So, I have some difficulty with evolutionary theory. I always have. I recognize I could be wrong entirely, and that God chose some way to do this. My difficulty lies with what happens to Adam. So, what if...
But Terry, look, can I just
stop
there?
Please.
Because here would be the argument. They would say, well, you can't stop the entire theory just based on what happens, right? I mean, they would say, if there's evolution, then it's evolution. It doesn't matter what the problems that you perceive as caused by.
So I would assume, let's assume the best. That group that you're talking about would be theistic evolutionists.
Okay.
And there are plenty of them. So that... they might say God used evolution as a process to get us here.
Okay.
That's a little hard to fit with the narrative. Because what the narrative tells us is that Adam and Eve were not sinners when they began, and they fell into sin. So instead of evolution coming to ascend to this hominoid that gets turned into Adam and Eve, we have a devolution of some sort.
Yeah.
And that's not easily reflected.
Right.
It's a status of their spiritual relationship with God, but it also affected the ground. It affected the earth. It affected the way animals behave with each other and humans behave with each other. So there are far-reaching effects of that that went backwards. I hear instead that, and in fact we learn death does not begin until then. It's one of the consequences. In fact, the Greek Orthodox Church suggests that the major consequence of Adam and Eve sinning and the fall was death itself. We became mortal. And it is Christ who comes back in the resurrection to make us immortal again. This point, though, is problematic because it would require the death of a number of human-like species, I guess, hominoids before they get to Adam. And that's not what the scripture is pointing us to. So there's a conflict in my mind between their theory and the scripture itself as it's laid out.
You know, it's interesting that we, you know, that there's this difficulty with a miraculous creation of the first Adam. And they on the best case scenarios, well, I would think that probably all theistic evolutionists believe in the virgin birth, or at least believe that Christ came in the flesh and that he was crucified, that he rose again the third day and ascended, all miraculous events. I mean, as miraculous as making the first Adam. So it's interesting that they would have that there's a problem seeing that God would specially create Adam at the very beginning. But the other thing, you know, you mentioned about sin coming in and death coming. I was reading, actually, Francis Schaeffer had a book called Genesis in Space and Time.
Yeah.
He had pointed out something I hadn't really given much thought to. A lot of times we think of, you know, sin, okay, you know, we almost trivialize it. Sin, you know, Eve had the apple, gave to Adam, okay, then they were cast out. He goes on and talks about, the deep rebellion that must have been there to cause that. And God had laden man with blessings. But then he mentions something. He doesn't develop it a lot, but he says something traumatic. You know, when we think of Noah and the flood, tremendous disruption all around it. Well, he says that as soon as death came, when death came, that the entire earth must have almost wrenched, and you know, because all of a sudden it goes from being very good and producing abundantly to being just changed dramatically. And he even says that there must have even been a change in the DNA or the genetic makeup of man that causes him now to die. That there's that much of a tremendous change that takes place that we don't take account of, which, you know, which of course would throw everything, you know, in terms of fossil records and maybe everything else into play. But he mentions
to read regular history like fossil records with this story and this history of the scripture. It's not an easy thing to kind of wed that way, but it fascinates me. I've thought for a long time that when we are saved, God does something in us that reverses the curse. Not all at once, perhaps, but turns us in some way. So if your point is anywhere near accurate, that there is...
Oh, it is.
Yeah, no. There's some kind of disruption in the universe and in the human universe, the microverse here. Maybe it's an amazing thing we don't celebrate enough that God, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ and that power, is able to turn us around so that we are able to make up the lack of where Adam fell.
Yeah. You know, I apologize. I've been thinking about this for so long. I kind of come in here full charged and ready to roll.
Good.
And
that's, no, yeah, that's yeah, good.
But, you know, I kind of took you off a little bit with... I wanted to talk to you because you've done a lot of study on this. I know that this has been something you've thought about a long time too. probably, in all reality, you know, I was joking, but probably far more systematically and in depth than I have. Tell me, with all of that, forget just setting aside, some of the, you know, theistic evolution. Why do you believe, when you come to this, what makes you confident that when God made Adam, that he's speaking historically at that point? Yeah. Because you mentioned that there, well, we all know that there's symbolism. This idea that I see the charge level, well, you're just all literalists. I don't know anyone who, honestly, I grew up in a fundamentalist Pentecostal church. I know literalism when we see it, but I don't think that anybody here doesn't understand that we read some things with symbols and we read some things with some things as history. Yeah. When I read Genesis 1, and all the way through 1 through 11, I don't have a problem reading that historically, that God does these things.
What I find interesting in raising the question of evolution a few minutes ago, I suppose that's the specter that has really clouded things.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I emphasize, I'm not a scientist. I don't know the answers to all of these questions. I just think there's some questions. But as a theologian, coming to the scripture, it appears to me that a number of people who want to make Adam and Eve into allegorical characters and not real historical beings, it feels to me that they're doing so because the evidence of science, as they call it, does not line up with what's here.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them will actually say that.
Yeah.
That expressly. So what do you do with what's here? Because if you're a Bible-believing Christian, you want to say this word has authority and is accurate in what it teaches.
Mm-hmm.
And useful and profitable for all kinds of teaching and doctrine and righteousness. So that's my concern, that sometimes outside forces are, and your word was scientism, are shaping the way we end up reading the word.
Mm-hmm.
Now, just leaving all of the science behind, when I look at Genesis 1 in Hebrew, it's very clear to me that this is a narrative poem.
Mm-hmm.
This is like an epic poem. It has characteristics of repetition that Hebrew poetry has. So it doesn't mean that what's here is untrue. It just means the writer decided in this first chapter, especially, in most of your English versions will have an indentation. It'll show, some of them will actually layer it like a poem. It'll show the poetic value there of it. Okay, so what does that mean? Here's how I've been thinking about it. This is the first time I've ever tried thinking this way. So let's see if it works. I love the poem about good fences make good neighbors. Maybe that's one all of us will know.
Okay.
But it's by Robert Frost. So it's the story of two people in New England.
Hey, listen, I'm a public school grad. I didn't even know that was a poem.
Well, I pastored in New England, so I guess I went back to this one quite a few times. I'm a public school grad too, so. But the poem is two neighbors come out once every year and mend this fence. But the fence is a stone wall. It's in New England, there's so much stone, they put the stones on fence lines.
Uh-huh.
And that's how you tell the difference. And if your cattle or something are there, they'll get through the holes. So you repair or mend the fence. But it's not like barbed wire. It's, it's rock. So the two in this poem come to mend the fence, and at the end of it, every time, the neighbor, older than this younger man that had just arrived, says, good fences make good neighbors. Well, I have to wonder, okay, that's, I mean, the poem is very effective in that way. I have to wonder if Frost ever experienced that.
Hmm.
You know, so I'm thinking, was this based on a real event? Did he know someone that happened to, or is he just imagining this?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'm taking that here, and I look at the scripture, and I'm first of all, it's not Adam and Eve writing about it, is it? It's someone that wasn't there, mm-hmm. but is being given revelation by God what mm-hmm. to say.
Right.
That's, I mean, if you don't believe that the scripture is a human book only, there are some who will say that, but if you believe God's in part in process of this, then there's some respect that is due to the scriptures. You walk towards it to hear it. But you also respect the style of literature that it is. So we understand some of the apocalyptic symbolism mm-hmm. of the book of Revelation mm-hmm. is kind of mysterious.
Well, I'm thinking about this because I understand that, but it seems to me that when it is allegorical or when it's clearly so. For instance, a lot of the picture of Revelation. I mean, you know, it's like one person said, do we really think that the Whore of Babylon is sitting, you know, that
yeah,
large,
right.
sitting on, you know, the
mountain, right.
you know, so, yeah. but in
that
Genesis,
seems more obvious.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so,
that's where I was going to head.
Oh, okay, I'm
yeah,
sorry. Yeah.
yeah.
Okay.
Because the poem of Robert Frost, if it's not based on actual events, it sure could be.
Okay.
So we would only need to hear from the author whether or not it was, if we were concerned about that. I think this story, and I use a story in a very good sense,
yeah.
I'm not using it as a myth.
Right.
I think this story tells a story that is accurate and is meant to give us some sense of what happened.
Okay.
But it's not going to give us a sense of everything that happened,
uh-huh.
either before it or after it. But at the end of the day, what are you supposed to say when you reach the end of chapter 1? God made every single thing.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't say that, I think you're missing the point of this. And there are things you can unfold from that. God also made humans. It's the only one of the events where he speaks to himself,
mm-hmm.
consults himself. God said, let us make the human in our own image,
right.
male and female. And it reaches an apex right there at the end, in the sixth day. This is the crown of the creation. If we eliminate that part of the story and say God didn't actually do that, God did not make Adam and Eve, the whole human race does not come from one
mm-hmm.
Couple, I think you begin to tear apart the foundation of the rest of Scripture,
mm-hmm.
at least as the people who were writing it understood it, because Paul, for example, will say, we call God our Father, who made, from whom all of humanity has come,
mm-hmm.
you know, the origin of us all, the Father of us all. So we have this common sharing thing. As a theologian, what I do with that, then, is I speak about what it means to be in the image of God. That is one of the most important items we as Christians have today. In fact, I think it's the major leg up that we have on every other form of moral argument.
You know, it's interesting that you mentioned, because the day before, what is the probe that just went by Pluto?
Yes, Last Horizons?
The New Horizons.
New Horizons.
New Horizon just went past Pluto,
right.
3.6 billion miles
right.
away, shooting back pictures. I was thinking it was kind of ironic because I was thinking about what our conversation is going to be here and about man as the crown jewel of creation. I was thinking, look what man is capable of. Stunning. Getting out there to and we haven't, I don't even think we've scratched the surface yet of
yeah,
what we're
yeah.
what's possible.
Yeah.
Thinking about that, you know, and being made in God's image.
Mm-hmm.
That what I was thinking of is that we are made in God's image, with the ability to do such incredible things. I'm not quite sure how to balance it, but I was saying it's amazing. Here, Dr. Cross and I are going to talk about being made in,
yeah.
made in God's image. And here we are exploring the entire universe and beyond
yeah.
and learning things and doing things that was, you know, inconceivable even 50 years ago. And, man, that's an amazing thing.
Yes.
Amazing.
Yep. It should have been front page news on the New York Times today, but it wasn't.
yeah.
It really should have been, because this is, I mean, to pass within 7,000 miles of the orbit of this item that's 3.6 billion miles away is astounding.
Yeah.
And the United States now is the only nation that has, from Mercury to Pluto, sent something by it and investigated it further. And now we have six more months of data coming in that they'll have to sort through.
16 months. Yeah, it's already almost 2 million miles past Pluto.
Yeah. I guess that shows you when you don't have, when you have a vacuum, it's less difficult to get really some speed build up, right?
Yeah, yeah.
What I see, though, about that isn't just, I mean, they could probably say, well, we've reached an evolutionary apex and we now have the ability to do such wonderful things.
Well, actually,
I think you and I can see that it's, okay, there's something that has caused us to do this, but it's, why would we even want to do this? Mm-hmm. What is the, what is it in us that is more than just the instinct that's in the animal?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm convinced we have instincts, but I think a lot of modern science and modern psychological science in particular goes very wrong when it suggests all we are a bundle of neurons and instincts.
Well, amazingly, almost all of what you read today in terms of psychology of man, it's all based on evolutionary psychology. And of course, Freud was a part of that, and Carl Jung, who was was very into the occult, incredibly into the occult.
Yes, he
was, and we're modeling, we're taking over a lot of that stuff. It's amazing. But so I think you're right. I think that we're looking in all the wrong places for motivations. We're also looking in the wrong place to think that we can rehabilitate some things that are just evil instead of understanding, you know, sin as it is. You know, sin was a foreign thing that came in and afflicts us and,
For me, then, the two things that would be lost if you do not in some way maintain that Adam was really there, however you want to say it, the historical Adam or was really made by God, the two things that are lost that are of major doctrinal importance are the image of God and sin.
Yeah.
I mean, both of those seem to be, okay, if this is just a story, then tell me what is the truth in that story. What do we take away from that, and why is it important at all if it's just a story?
Well, Terry, you and I talked to, I'm sorry, Dr. Cross.
No, Terry.
You know, we talked a little while ago on atonement, and one of the fundamental shifts that's going on with this shift away from historical Adam or, you know, an evolution and this whole, what does that mean about original sin? Okay, if there is no original sin, and if there's no historical Adam, if there's just kind of this evolution and sin kind of always, I mean, evil was always kind of there. There's that dualism again. But you know, what does that mean about atonement? Well, can there really be atonement for a sin that really wasn't original? And what does all that mean? It's amazing how they're trying to redefine all of that and. Based on no historical, an evolutionary approach, completely evolutionary, that, you know, that Adam only is a representative of a group of people that evolved. The best of them say that one person evolved out of that group and that there was federalism in him. But it kind of breaks down. They say, well, really, it's probably more likely that a whole group of them are counted as one. But I think. You know, now again, I'm going to go back to me. I probably read Genesis probably maybe a little bit more literal. For this reason, this is why I do. I look where God constantly goes back. Well, in the Ten Commandments, I mean, for Moses, listen, here's what you're going to do. I just like I built the world, I created the world, and in 6 days on the seventh day I rested. This is what I want you to do. There's this, and then Jesus, not so much in this. In the six-day paradigm, but Jesus going back and saying, "Hey, listen! In the very beginning, this is the way it was." Mm-hmm. It's amazing because we have theologians today that are saying that Jesus was just a man of his time. He didn't have the. I mean, it's like God Himself doesn't have the knowledge of what He did, and so He's just kind of speaking to accommodate the knowledge of the day, and Paul, and some of them are actually coming out saying, hey, listen, if we're going to do away with Adam, we have to do away with Paul.
Yeah.
Because Paul's theology, you know, almost all of his theology rests on that real historical Adam and Jesus being the second Adam approach.
Two passages in Romans 5, where through one man death entered the world, and through because of him sin entered. And then in 1 Corinthians 15, it speaks of Christ as the second Adam versus mm-hmm. the first Adam, and that's about the resurrection. There are a couple of things. Peter Enns, for example, is one who has more recently basically said, I think Moses or whoever wrote this got it wrong.
Yeah.
And has said it that clearly.
Yeah.
And that he's part of a very primeval culture and couldn't have done anything more than to tell the story. Well, my point for Peter Enns is, why in the world are you still
a Christian?
Then the second part he's just more recently come out with is that Paul got it wrong.
Yeah.
So how can I, sitting... This goes back to the first thing I said. My stance toward the Scripture mm-hmm. needs to be one of respect, I think, because otherwise I can start to see pieces of this that I think will fit together as something that human beings have cobbled together.
Yeah.
But behind that, even if they did cobble it together, I believe God was orchestrating it. So yeah. I'm not as concerned, mm-hmm. hence I'm not a biblical scholar. And I'll say that right up front. I'm not as concerned about whether...
Wait a second, stop. What did you just said you're not a biblical scholar?
No, I'm a theologian, which is a different thing.
Oh.
Yeah.
I thought they were all the same.
No.
Okay. Yeah, I've had enough, 20 years. I don't know.
I've had enough Old and New Testament to certainly be one, but I won't claim that.
Okay. I claim it for him.
Thank you. But what I have to say then is, then what is the point of all this that God has written?
Yeah.
And if it's simply to tell stories that old people told one another... If you pull Paul out of it, and you pull whoever wrote the first book out of it, what gives you the right to do that?
Uh-huh.
I think it's a modern understanding of accuracy that we place on the Scripture.
Well, what amazes me is that you hear all these people that are like, okay, these were primitive people, they had to have these stories, and I'm thinking, well... No, because the easiest way, if it was just that God wanted to communicate in some story that they could understand, was an evolutionary story. I mean, you know, that's what the entire world was in the time of Israel. They were all evolutionists. They all believed that they'd come, you know, evolved from different things. I mean, the easiest thing for them to have done would have been to say, okay, you were created over, you know, 10 million years. I mean, that was a radical thought when it comes in and man is made out of nothing. That is a radical thought, and I mean that lifts the discussion, that lifts the debate. If I like what he died. He wasn't a Christian. He wrote Entertaining or Amusing Ourselves to Death.
Yes. Yeah.
He said that what was amazing about the Hebrew Bible was and the word was that it forced them to think conceptually, which nobody else had ever done. And by forcing them to think conceptually and to not have images and to think in terms of it actually elevated the entire culture. I think that these guys are reading back into something. I think that evolutionary theory has so grasped them that we have this pride of place chronologically. We're today, so we're smarter. Really? Than how they build the pyramids and how, I mean...
That, I think it's the hubris of the modern human being that we're better than the groups that have come before us.
Yeah.
Just one example. Were there world wars before this last century? You know, so we've created incredible technology, which we also have used to destroy each other.
Yeah.
So there's a sense in which if we start to be proudful over what it is that we as an I just read a sermon not long ago from Karl Barth, a theologian in the early 1900s, and he was preaching at his village church. He wrote his sermons in manuscripts, so we still have them. And it's his sermon the Sunday after the Titanic sunk. And it's a sermon against human pride and the hubris that rises up in us and that we're tempted to, that this boat cannot be sunk.
Yeah, in fact, did they say God himself couldn't sink the boat?
Perhaps, yeah. I don't know. But it's I think, a sermon that we all need to be hearing as moderns, because we feel pretty good about ourselves on this.
What was that? I'm going to have to go back. I'd like to actually go back. What was that? That was Karl Barth after?
Karl Barth, the Sunday after the Titanic sank. And it's a powerful sermon. I think it's in a book by William Willimon.
Okay.
That has two sermons of his in there. For me, then, there's a part that I want to come back to on those two issues that I think are fundamentally important. If you're saying Adam is not real, and Eve, what part of the story is real to you and why?
Yeah.
And how can you pick and choose? Now, there is another biblical scholar, New Testament scholar, N.T. Wright, who has a much more sophisticated discussion of this. And he suggests that it isn't, in the Romans passage, about the forensic discussion of righteousness being acquitted before God, but instead it's about returning to Jesus, who was able to do what Adam did not do. And that's what Romans 5 mentions. His argument is much more sophisticated and has some weight to it. He's not saying Paul's wrong. He's saying our understanding of Paul is a little confused there. In the same way, I think if you're denying Adam, you're affecting the area of image of God and the area of sin that we share. Those are, I think, the two doctrinal issues that are most important for us today. I find those two being confused immensely by Christians. Number one, the image of God can be used about respect and sanctity for life. So why our whole Western civilization is built on that understanding of sanctity. Okay, there are reasons why Christians were outraged that ISIS was beheading fellow Christians, other than just fellow humanity dying. But them beheading anybody, I think, would be an outrage for most of us who live in the West. And this is a blink of an eye for them. What is the difference? It's the difference of the basis of their ethical understanding of what is right and what is wrong and what is valuable in the world. And the Christian takes its understanding back to Genesis 1. There's value in the world because there, and that, by the way, is one of the greater explanations. There are six times the image of God is used in the whole Bible. And this is one of the longest and most clear explanations of what is meant by that. That is right there in that first chapter. You throw that out, I think you throw out much of the moral reasoning that we offer as Christians for why we do what we do and what's right and what's wrong.
I think there's a very practical thing that's just happened recently is we're seeing gay marriage approved, and even a lot of times Christians are you know, just kind of accepting of it, whether they agree with it or not, they're accepting. You know, but we've been arguing on tradition. Tradition can be overthrown. I mean, tradition is nothing. You can start a new tradition tomorrow, okay? But I think when you throw away some of these, when Jesus referred back to Adam and Eve, he said, this is the way that God did it. Okay, it's rock solid there. But if you take away Adam and Eve, then you really don't have, you don't really have a theological, you may have a traditional basis, but who cares about, honestly, who cares about tradition? If that's all it is, then we're free to, we really are free to create our own relationships. But because God himself rooted it there and specifically said, this is where it started, and this is what's normal, this is what's right, then we stay there. But if we wipe away a historic Adam and Eve, then really I don't think we really have the right to complain about where marriage and everything else is going. That's because it certainly doesn't make, because there's a lot of things that have been done in history that,
once again, my concern is if you're picking and choosing what you think is real and where the scripture writers got it wrong, what's to say you're not going to take Jesus Christ and say, you know, they just made up this story about the cross and resurrection, or this has happened in the last 25 years with the Jesus seminar. You know, you put in different colors of rocks.
He was resurrected only in the imagination of the disciples.
And even their sayings of Jesus have been suspect. So what did Jesus say?
Yeah.
Well, if you take a look at their five Gospels, which is the publication from that group, there's precious little that Jesus says.
Who was it? Famously, I don't remember who it was, but in one book they came down to the only thing that they really believed that Jesus said was Jesus wept or something.
Yeah. it was like the one that shocked me that almost all of them thought Jesus really said has something to do with his statement on the way to the cross, and he says to the women who are mourning him something about the babes, or it's a strange statement about trees, I think. I wasn't thinking of going there, so I hadn't thought of it in a long time. So the stranger the statement, must be it, that Jesus actually said that.
Yeah.
Because they wouldn't have written it. It's a really hard statement to interpret. Well, if you're going to, we've seen this play out. The historical Jesus was a study from 1850 all the way up until now. It's gone through three major phases and now maybe a fourth. So that if you study what you think with your own understanding of history is the reality of what actually happened, what you could come up with is what John Dominic Crossan has done. The Irish scholar says, Jesus was a cynic who was a Mediterranean Jew, and that's all we can know. He was a peasant. And that's it. Well, okay, so what does that do then for one's faith at that point?
Yeah.
If that's what you think is the only thing that can be established by history. I think here's where they're missing an understanding of the purpose of Scripture, which is for the Holy Spirit to quicken our hearts when we hear it and read it and assure us that we are not just making this up and are not just believing a lie.
Yeah.
So John Calvin had something that I think was really important here, and it was the inner testimony of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
So how do I know Scripture is true? I know because the Spirit of God who wrote this text is also alive in me and is making me understand this is true. So if you pull that out and get to decide where and what becomes your Bible, you could expect all kinds of aberrations from, well, I don't like that, so I'm going to choose this. So that's, I think, very, very, very frequently what I hear on any moral issue that we might have. You know, who are you to judge me? You're supposed to show love. Well, that's a real misunderstanding of Christian faith as it's portrayed here in Scripture, and it's just taking one verse and making that your mantra. I don't consider that to be Christian. I consider that to be an aberration of the Christian faith. So I think we have a lot of people who are Christians in their name, but not Christian in terms of a follower of Christ.
It goes back to Jesus said, you know, my sheep hear my voice. When you talked about the Spirit, I think that, you know, I'll say this: I'm pretty much an optimist. I think that the church has went through attacks and has come out fine. In fact, many times the heretical aspect has caused the church to regain focus and actually concretely put down what they have believed and defend it right. I think maybe it seems a little bit strange today because maybe we forgot that we have to defend the faith sometimes. I mean, get back in and defend it.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that.
No.
You know, that iron sharpening iron, and that, you know, that whole idea of, hey, listen, pulling down the vain philosophies that exalt themselves against the knowledge of God.
Yeah. I want to be clear that I'm not judging, well, it sounded like it, I was, I guess, a bit ago, but I don't want to be judging whether these folks who are writing are Christian or not. I just have a hard time wondering how someone can state Moses got it wrong and Paul got it wrong and still follow Christ in a way that is meaningful, that still uses the scripture as your guide.
Yeah.
That's, for me, the issue. Okay, if you believe in theistic evolution, and I can live with you, I can have you in the same church I go to, hopefully I'm broad enough to be able to do that in my sphere, but there are certain things that I think, once you step across, create such damage
But you're not I'm just curious that you accept. But you're not a theistic evolutionist.
I'm not.
Yeah. Okay. No. But you're also not a young.
I'm not a young Earth.
You're not a young Earth guy.
Yeah.
And I'm just and
yeah. You kind of.
No, I just didn't want. I didn't want people to leave here.
No.
Thinking, you know,
yeah.
Thinking that you were with me, because you don't. You definitely don't want to be identified too closely with me. As you saw, you're not a theistic evolutionist, but you can live with it. And there are some guys, I just found out, I'm surprised. I didn't know that Tim Keller was kind of in that camp. And I like a lot of what Tim Keller's doing.
Sure.
I think, but here's where I think the difference is. I don't know if we're not going to judge, because the Bible says if they confess that they're a Christian, that I think you have to kind of at least take it at face value and let God, the one that you know, he says at the end of time, the angels come and sort them out. Okay, that's not my job. There's going to be wheat and tares in the church.
Sure.
And, you know, I just hope the tares aren't me.
Yes.
You know, the but here's I think a different, not like a Tim Keller, who's a theistic evolution. Okay, big deal. But he's not out there promoting. He's actually taken it as a defensive position from my perspective.
Yeah, and the fact that you only just recently found out.
Yeah,
he's that's not his
no
number one placard.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, there's some other guys that I'm trying to think the other day. He wrote it. Alistair McGrath.
Yes,
I didn't realize that he is also now. He comes at it. He was a biology guy.
Yeah,
and
two PhDs,
and actually wrote a really good trilogy starting with nature. In fact, he said something that stays with me today. We shouldn't call it nature, we should call it creation. I thought, wow, I need to start doing that. So he's in that camp. I'm not. Here's what but I don't see him as this big proponent. Here's where I think it is. It's, you know, the Bible talks about those who teach are held to a higher level.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure where this is, and I'm going to leave it to guys like you and the rest of the, maybe the church, when they come together to think about this. But I do wonder about people who are so driven to overthrow these things, and they call themselves teachers. I'm not so sure that without saying that they're not Christians, I'm not so sure that there shouldn't be a huge public rebuke towards them, because you know, it's almost like they're teaching my people to sin in a lot of cases. Of course, now I feel passionately about that. This whole idea of degrading man, who I think is degrading to Jesus Christ himself, I'm just not sure what the line is. I'm not comfortable. I'm like you. I'm not going to say that they're not, because if they say that Jesus Christ came, lived in the flesh, died, rose again, and they call Jesus Lord, but when they deny all the fundamental doctrines around it that kind of lead to that, you're like, well, okay, if you want to believe it, but don't be teaching it. I mean, if you're someone who's out there like a Peter Enns, and I mean, man, that's his, you know, you're out of it. You're not smart. You're stupid. You're caught in mythology. If you don't believe this stuff, you're just going to have to accept it.
In 1996, Clark Pinnock wrote a chapter in his book Flame of Love that I kind of took him to task on. Because he supports theistic evolution. And part of the reason why he does it is because he wants scientists to come over to the Christian faith. So that there should be a way that we kind of are able to see each other. I think that's wonderful. The trouble is, by conceding to theistic evolution off the bat, he's having to do all other kinds of things, like say there were human beings before Adam, and that death was in the world before Adam and Eve sinned. And I have yet to see a single scientist come to Christian faith because of theistic evolution.
Okay,
so if I'm a stick in the mud, I mean, this is stuff I don't talk about much. If I'm a stick in the mud and an old curmudgeon because I still believe God created the world, I don't have any skin off my nose on this issue. It's God created the world. I can believe that here. I believe other things in scriptures, as you said earlier. What I think is the difficulty is if someone is not believing, then they may see me as just every one of my views are ironclad and my head is in the ground. I'm an ignoramus because I won't listen to anything else. So I think it's important for those of us who might be called conservative in the way we read Scripture also to know the other side. And clearly you've been reading and doing that. But the reason to do that is to have a much more nuanced and a much... I mean, we could take a sledgehammer to what could require just simply a little chisel tap.
What fun is that?
Yeah, okay. Right.
No.
But I'm not saying that you've sledgehammered. No. I don't know. But that I'm saying that I think we really have a responsibility to read up the best we can and find ways of defending without becoming too close-minded. There's always the place where I could be wrong on something. I doubt that when I get to heaven, God is going to say to me, "Welcome in because your theology is correct."
Right. We're saved by grace.
Right.
Through faith.
And through Jesus Christ.
That's right, yeah.
But I put a but there because if I say that without the but, hey, Mormons believe in Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. Jehovah's Witnesses believe in Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Is there something about what I believe in Jesus Christ that is also going to be influential about how I live?
Yeah.
And I also think that that is a question about Scripture. My living is different if I'm in command over the Scripture instead of the Scripture over me.
There's one last thing. We've went a long ways and everything, but there's one thing I do want to point out, and I guess this is just a personal irritation, because it seems like when anybody talks from a biblical standpoint that's real or historical or is trustworthy, people say, well, you're anti-science. That is so far from the truth. Christianity, the belief in Christ created science, because as Eric Sauer said, he said, you know, we created a great distinction between the creator and the creation, and so we were able to investigate. We weren't afraid of gods and demons lurking behind every rock and stone, you know, and we didn't think of the earth as Gaia, the earth goddess. We saw it as creation.
Right.
And maybe some people have taken that too far. I think that that's way overplayed. I don't think that that's even close. When they complain about the diminishing, I don't think it's even close. But even if it is, the fact is that without Christianity, without the foundation of Jesus Christ, being who he is, and in him is all wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, there is no scientific investigation. All of science glorifies God. I'm for science. I'm for penicillin. I'm for new horizons. I think that man is called to incredible greatness. But this goes to one last thing, and I'll turn it over to you for the last word, because I've kind of went rambling here today, and you're really the guy that people should be listening to, Jesus Christ came. I mean, the Bible says that Christ was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Before man was created, in however you want to put it, God knew what was going to transpire. I guess Clark Pinnock wouldn't like that either, because he doesn't believe God knows the future. But the fact is that C.S. Lewis in a novel talked about how man, you know, he had man, a version of man being on other planets, and it was because the Son of Man came as a man, and therefore there could never be anything higher in all of the universe, because God the Son was embodied as a human flesh. Now, that's fiction, okay? But there's truth to that. I mean, you talk about that, there's truth. Jesus Christ came as a human. I mean, did he really come as a gorilla who evolved and, was... No, I think that when God made man, he made him knowing that his son, I mean, when we made an image, there's something even about the physical makeup of man. In Hebrews it says, a body hast thou prepared for me. And that's an amazing thing from my perspective. And by this attack on a historic Adam, from my perspective, again, I want to make sure, because this is a touchy subject, I want to make sure people know I'm speaking for me. I think that's really an attack on the person and even the nature and the character of Jesus Christ. That's my thinking. And you have the last, as Bill O'Reilly would say, you have the last word. I don't know why he says it. He never lets him have it.
I think there's a part of this that really behooves us to look at more carefully, and it is the idea that Jesus Christ is the perfect human.
Mm-hmm.
So he has done, where Adam's failed, he has repaired that wall and done that. And therefore, if Jesus Christ is the perfect human, we learn from the life of Jesus Christ what it is we're to be doing as human beings.
But let me throw this in. But he's the perfect human embodied, not just as a concept or an idea.
It almost makes no sense to speak of concept.
That's what people would say. It's the idea. But when you say that, I know what you mean. If they say that,
it'll deny the incarnation and becoming flesh. And that throughout the last 2,000 years has been a cornerstone, one of several of the Christian faith. So if you pull that apart, it's meaningless. Yeah.
Any corrective words you want to say, make sure that you...
I can't remember. We've been rambling so long.
Okay, yes. One last thing. I just want to say that it's been great to have Dr. Terry Cross, and maybe we'll get a chance to come back to this and maybe some other controversial topics that are important for the church today and get a chance to talk about. And let me point out that the words that I spoke, any mistakes are with mine alone. It goes kind of at the beginning of a book. Mistakes are mine. All the good stuff is his. We look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you. Thanks, Terry.